Perseverance, you're the most horrible theorist ever.
Very dangerous for
even the microphone.
Hey guys, today we're going to show you a little bit of the spectroscopy block that we have in the lab.
This is our polarization spectroscopy block. The point of it is to lock the master laser onto a particular absolute frequency which hits a selected atomic transition. The polarization spectroscopy, which is a bit different from saturated absorption spectroscopy in the way that we're measuring the angle the polarization rotates after interacting with an atomic resonance when the light goes through the rubidium vapor cell over here.
Mm-hmm. And we're counteracting Doppler broadening because this gas cell is just at room temperature or a bit above room temperature.
Not because it's above the room temperature, it's because it's at non-zero temperature.
Yeah, non-zero
any
temperature.
Any momentum induces Doppler effect for each atom. So all the oscillators which we have in the system, they move at some non-zero velocity. And the non-zero velocity causes Doppler shifts. So when the ensemble is such as an atomic gas, where everything almost an ideal gas, where all the particles move at their own velocities, very high velocities, like several hundred meters per second, in random directions, you can imagine that Doppler broadening happens also in all the directions. So eventually, when you measure the spectrum with the directed light, which only peaks in one direction but fills all the possible randomized oscillators flying around, the spectrum will be broadened substantially because each velocity group would contribute a shift.
But then the point is that unless you can counteract this, you can't target the
that's
frequency.
Saturated absorption spectroscopy,
but
too.
The
so
aim
it's
is the same here, right?
The aim is the same, but this is like the polarization spectroscopy.
Yeah.
So I would say we probably have to abstract this scheme as a frequency locking block and also line width narrowing block. So by locking a laser onto an absolute reference, which is now an atomic transition serving us as an absolute reference, frequency reference. We actually, first of all, we stabilize the mean frequency of the laser light, and we also narrow down its line width substantially by orders of magnitude because it tends to lock dynamically, which means that any deviation from the center of that absolute frequency of the reference would be compensated for, and then the laser would narrow down its effective line width. So why do we need this? Because we want to exactly control how light interacts with atoms. The lasers are typically chosen in such a way that the laser line width and frequency spectrum is much narrower than the characteristic atomic transition we work with. So for example, our transitions here in the range of 5 to 6 megahertz, and the laser is about 100 kilohertz, if I remember correctly. So it's much narrower, and we can surely address a particular atomic transition if it's very, even if it's very narrow. There are several techniques, pretty standard by now, which are used to lock the laser to an atomic transition. So we have a rubidium cell here, rubidium vapor cell, placed inside this oven. It's slightly warmed. I'm heating it up to 60 degrees, I think. It's not absolutely necessary, but it allows us to control the parameters of this vapor and condition our spectral lines, which we measure with the photodiode later on. So the lasers pass from different sides of the cell and eventually hit the photodiodes, and this is where we measure the signal, the transmission signal through the cell. So the essential part of it is that the lasers probe an atomic transition and scan around that transition. And by doing so, they generate a signal which we call error signal. This signal can be used to correct the laser parameters and return the laser back to the norm, back to the atomic resonance. The laser itself is a drifting system, but the atom is not. So we can probe the atomic transition and feed back to the laser so that it stabilizes the laser line.
All right. So can we see it working?
Yes. So if we turn on the laser, so we see the spectrum here. Actually, all the four resonances, this is polarization spectrum, actually. These are anti-symmetric polarization resonances. Here, for example, if I cover one of the saturating transitions, we will not see the hyperfine transitions. So I can squeeze the spectrum back in place. So there are two rubidium isotopes represented here. One isotope is on the outer sides, and on the inner sides there are two other slightly saturated isotopes, but this is no problem for this system. And now if I remove the counter-propagated beams, needs a bit of alignment, but you can see that there are hyperfine anti-symmetric peaks forming over here, like here. We can actually lock on one of those transitions here, for example, in our point. I choose a lock point and then lock it. Just keeps locked. Then I can unlock it. So the laser electronics, when it's aligned and feeds back the signal properly, it can scan across that peak and zoom in and actually keep the laser parameterized in such a way that it's locked to that absolute line. So this line is red from an atomic transition directly. That's why we choose this point over here, and any deviation from it, which you can see as a point scanning up and down. There are several points. It's just the electronics are suggesting different lock points, and they go up and down so crazily, I would say, because we have the light in the lab right now. It's a huge noise source. So normally we would, under experimental conditions, we would operate without light. So if I turn off the light, all these fluctuations will go and we will see very stable point levels. I can probably do this now. If I turn off the lights, then the video will also go. But now you see that nothing actually happens to these points, and I can choose one of them quite reliably and start working. For example, if I desire to work with this peak, I just point out to that peak and press the lock button, and then the laser electronics enables a feedback loop which continuously pulls the atomic resonance and corrects the laser position back to the frequency defined by the atomic transition. So now the laser relies on the atomic transition only, and its laser line will be much narrower. We can measure the laser line by measuring the error signal, the residual error signal in the locked regime. So once we lock it, the residual fluctuations would describe would be proportional to the line width. And this is what we can experimentally quantify. This is quite easy. You can actually see it here. This is an unlocked signal. And now when I press a button, I would just lock it in the same way, and you will see what will happen to this line. So I lock it now, and you see this is the stabilized laser readout, I would say. So we basically, or the atomic cell readout. So it's the transmission signal through the cell, but since we keep returning it to the same position, it doesn't scan across the resonant peak. So it stays at the peak, exactly at the peak. And the width of this line would describe how much of the residual error is still in the line width. So basically that reduction, I can unlock again. So you see the reduction is probably by a factor of, I don't know, maybe 20 or 30, maybe more, needs to be properly quantified. So it fluctuates around the resonance, but once I lock it, it gets very, very stable. I cannot resolve it actually below the pixel noise here. So actually it can be very narrow. So if I get the root mean square value of it, I can actually tell by how much I narrowed down the laser line width. If it was, for example, 100 kilohertz or like 500 kilohertz unlocked, then it probably became something like within tens of kilohertz. This is exactly how we do this. And after the laser is prepared in this way, we can start working with the atoms, because now we know that we have sufficient precision to hit particular resonances. Now we can manipulate the resonances in a controllable fashion. We can shift this line with nonlinear crystals, or even with just laser settings by several megahertz, choose another atomic transition in the hyperfine manifold and hit exactly that transition without thinking what the laser is doing. We can actually dedicatedly address that line. All right.
Okay.
That's it for today.
Hope you enjoyed that. We'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.